over the Barbadian Ocean.
An explosion and we are descending immediately. We have fire on board.
Cuban 4-5-5, we return to the field.
The target is 1-7-2-4.
Okay, Silver, Cuban 4-5-5. We are requesting immediately landing. Cierra la puerta, cierra la puerta.
The target is 1-7-2-7.
At the time, we had a cousin. She woke us up and she kept saying to all of us, sit down, you need to sit down. I remember her saying to my mother, you know, please sit down, sit down. And she said the plane that Raymond was on, I remember she kept saying, I think the plane that Raymond was on went down, and my mother screamed. Because we can assume what happens next, that there will be no survivors.
The wreckage fell near Barbados. There were no survivors. There had been 73 passengers and crew on board. Amongst them, the 24 members of the Cuban national fencing team. Many were teenagers. Two men were convicted in Venezuela of placing the bombs, but the suspected masterminds remained elusive. CIA documents reveal that days before the bombing, an associate of Orlando Boss was overheard saying, "We're going to hit a Cuban airplane. Orlando has the details." Boss was detained for the crime in Venezuela, but was never convicted. In 1989, Boss emerged back in the United States. He was arrested, but only for a parole violation. The anti-Castro cause meant votes, and Miami Republicans campaigned for his freedom.
He became the cornerstone of the campaign by Ileana Ross Leighton for her run for the U.S. Congress. The campaign became Free Orlando Bosch. Her campaign manager was a young, ambitious politician named Jeb Bush. And Jeb Bush's father was the Vice President of the United States and then was the President of the United States.
Mr. President, it is an honor and a thrill that you have come to Miami on behalf of my campaign. I'm extremely grateful for all of your support and encouragement in the past weeks.
And despite protests from the U.S. Justice Department, particularly from Bush's own Attorney General, saying that this is one of the worst terrorists operating in our hemisphere, that we under no circumstances should allow him to remain here, President George Bush overruled them all at the request of his son and granted residency to Orlando Bosch.
He had spent the past 13 years in Venezuelan and American prisons. Bosch's relatives say he is in poor health and just wants to spend time with his family. The Justice Department has tried to deport Bosch as a terrorist, but 31 countries refuse to take him.
Orlando Bosch settled down with his family in Miami. He's a keen landscape painter who depicts Cuban scenes remembered from his youth.
Es que puedo pedirle cuál es su pintura favorita.
Sí, esa de ella. 77.
¿Cuando era preso?
Sí.
Sí. Sáquenla. Sáquenla.
¿Qué acá?
¿Qué hago?
Está muy cansado, ¿no?
Mírame. Dime que no se parece chinito a ese. ¿Ah? ¿Chinito?
grande.
Quiere mucho a los niños.
Sí, Orlando Bosch, el hombre que yo conocí. Orlando Bosch, el bueno. Digo, Orlando Bosch, digo hermano.
¿Por qué Castro lo menciona a usted tantas veces? Cada vez que tiene que acusar a alguien, doctor Orlando Bosch.
Lo que soy es que más daño lo ha hecho. Es que verdad, nosotros, yo.
¿Por qué Castro le tiene miedo?
Bueno, me tiene sentenciado 3 veces a condena a muerte.
Doctor, una pregunta. Usted ahorita se refería al atentado al avión en Barbados. ¿Usted tuvo que ver con eso? ¿Con el avión?
No, le tengo que decir que no.
Está bien.
Y no es solo ese. El avión de Jamaica. Explotó el. Y el avión aquí de los paquetes. Que llevaba los paquetes de Cuba. Que lo volaron también. Entonces, a mí me acusan de estos aviones. Ustedes aviones de Castro. A mí me acusan. Yo los dejo. No digo que no, ni que sí. En una guerra, este país. Y todo el mundo, en una guerra, usted tiene que derribar los aviones del enemigo, usted tiene que destruir los submarinos del enemigo, todo lo que usted pueda. Porque es así, yo considero que nosotros estamos en guerra con Castro. Y en la guerra, todo es válido.
This really upset a lot of people because it turned out that most of the people on this plane were civilians. There really is no evidence that these were very, very important high-level Cuban officials on the plane or military officials, etc.
Inclinamos decididamente por la primera tesis. La CIA tuvo una participación directa en la destrucción del avión de Cubana en Barbados. El reclutamiento de ciudadanos y el empleo del territorio de otros países para realizar actos de esa naturaleza son métodos típicos de la CIA.
Castro plays David to our Goliath beautifully, and we give him an opportunity almost on a weekly basis. We do something which allows him to put the blame on us. We're unable to deal rationally with Cuba.
After the plane bomb, America and Cuba did, for once, get talking. In 79, President Jimmy Carter even invited Castro to visit the States.
The last time Fidel Castro made this journey, it was shortly after the revolution that brought him to power. Nothing that's happened since has made the visit less of a security risk for him, and on the plane coming over, he was asked if he was wearing a bulletproof vest.
What suit? Everybody says you always have
a bulletproof vest. Un chaleco a prueba de balas.
No.
No. But there was a plot to kill Castro just after he touched down on American soil.
Tengo un chaleco moral.
I have a moral one.
A moral
vest.
Tomorrow, when he makes his speech, the United Nations itself will allow no visitors. And instead of the usual sequence of national leaders coming to the podium, Fidel Castro will have the session all to himself. A sensible precaution, since last time he was here, in 1960, he went on for 4 hours and 29 minutes.
The hatred still burned in one of Castro's oldest enemies. Antonio Vesciana plotted to hide plastic explosives inside a softball and throw it at Castro's car.
sino que tenía que ser una bomba de contacto. Cuando eso se lanzara, al tocar el carro explotaba. Y eso es una cosa de mucho riesgo y tiene que saber muy bien, tiene que ser un experto. Y el señor Edel Montiel había sido preparado por la CIA en explosivo y sabía perfectamente lo que podía hacer.
But Fabian Escalante's undercover agents were already on the case.
Teníamos un dispositivo en ese momento. Habían personas cerca de Antonio Veciana. Y bueno, finalmente le suministramos al FBI la información. Mire, el día tal, a tal hora, se planea este atentado contra el compañero Fidel y pudimos desarticularlo. Es decir, fue un año muy interesante, fueron años muy interesantes. Y yo creo que en ese combate nosotros salimos victoriosos.
¿Usted era terrorista?
En aquel tiempo sí, en aquel tiempo, pero desde hace mucho tiempo que dejé de terrorista.
A ver.
Es decir, sacrifiqué a mí, el mérito no era mío, el mérito era de mi esposa y de mis hijos, que me veían de tarde en tarde. Y cuando uno tiene la victoria todavía hay una recompensa, pero aquí no hubo recompensa.